Okay, we have some commotions over here, but that's great because there's commotions in the world, isn't there? And that's not stopping us at all from our non-dual positivity training. This is what we do here. There's a great opportunity coming, but we will only accept the opportunity if we're aware of it, if we see it, if we see it. And we will only see it if we're in a very positive state of mind, you might say. We certainly want to practice non-dual positivity as much as possible in preparation for a great, great, great opportunity. Now, not everyone's going to do this. Why? There are those in this world that are so familiar with fear, they think reality is fear-based. And the notion of going to a situation where there's no imperilment, where that infers invulnerability, that infers reality, to them, they think that would be an absence of reality. They think fear is reality. So they want to stop it. And the idea that someone else might do it threatens them so badly because that gives them the idea like it's doable. Or at least some, it's like they think they're leaping off a cliff. And they say, oh my gosh, that's setting a bad example because suddenly I feel something within me that wants to leap too. Because within every one of us, we want to accept reality as it is. And so there's a pull within everyone. But they experience this pull as threatening, that's going to threaten them. They think that they'll leap into non-reality. They think fear is reality and no fear is non-reality. So they want to stop this. They don't want anybody to take this opportunity. I said that Jesus came back, and he's already back here in friendship. He said, I come to relate with everyone, and just as a friend, as in friendship, as a friend. And no response, virtually no response, because people say, oh, this is threatening. This is threatening. They find it threatening. They find no fear threatens what their belief in what they believe is reality. So we have this difficulty of those who say, hey, here's this great opportunity. We have this great opportunity to relate with Jesus as a friend. Nobody's taken him up on it, hardly anyone. This shows how frightened we are, how severe our continuity fear is. So here we do non-dual positivity training, and we want to go into 216 in the best possible shape. So I'm continuing to eat as well as I possibly can, for example, and continue strength and flexibility exercises. I will do some cardio. I'm doing cardio also, but I'm not trying to overdo it. I don't want to run myself into the ground. And trying to keep practicing non-dual practices, neither nor practice. I can, I will, I already am. Also practice. Various assertions continue. So we want to be mentally very, very good shape. Physically, very, very good shape. We have one of a very positive outlook. So, what are some of the habits we can do in this preparation? Preparation for opportunity. Opportunity favors the prepared mind. Someone said that, maybe Mark Twain. Opportunity favors the prepared mind. There's also say luck is the residue of design. Luck is the residue of design. But we'll say opportunity favors the prepared mind. And certainly is true. So whatever opportunity arrives, those who have prepared in a positive way are going to have a much better opportunity to go with that, to go with that. And of course, non-dual positivity training is helpful no matter what. It's the way to shed our fear, really. Now, keep in mind that problems can never be resolved at the level at which they arrive. There's duality is inherently problemistic belief system. It's impossible to be dualistic, believe in dualism, without feeling a sense of problematicness. It's a sense of imperilment, really, is what how we structured it. A sense of imperilment. It's impossible. So when people say, solve my problems, this is not possible. We can only recognize from the non-dual position that there are no problems. So either we either see problems or we don't see any problems. That's the only option we ha two options that we choose between. There's never the option of we see problems but we fix them, resolve them, really, truly resolve them. The feeling to resolution, we think, well, the feeling of imperilment, the feeling is that's no longer there. No, the feeling of problematicness remains in a dualistic outlook, always. The dualistic outlook of success and failure, for instance. It doesn't matter how much we succeed, the specter of failure still looms in front of us and around us and behind us, always, you see. Whereas from the non-dual perspective, there's nothing that we need to do. There's nothing that needs to be accomplished. There's no narrative that needs to be spun. We are our base, and we can call it the baseless base, meaning it's the base is not based on anything else. So it's clear light. It is the baseless base is what we are, and it's perfect. It's flawless, and it feels blissful, joyful, feels perfect, smoothly perfect. Not oscillating, not peaks and valleys, but smoothed out perfection. From this perspective, nothing has to happen. No narrative needs to take place. No success nor failure, neither success nor failure, nor in between, nor anything in between, nor a neutral between success and failure. It's reality is not based on success. It's not based on failure. It's not based on the absence of success nor the absence of failure. It's not based on a neutral between success and failure. Reality is what it is. It already is what it is. It's the base. From this perspective, there aren't any problems. There's never the problem of establishing a base, being in the base, remaining in the base, fixing the base, doing anything at all to what we are. To our being, there's never this issue at all, never this problem at all. So we either feel a sense of problematicalness, imperilment, inferring that reality isn't real, this sense of it's a problem, it bothers a problem, or we feel no problem, no problem whatsoever. Never can we feel solve, we think we've solved most problems, but we still have one problem. It's still problematicalness entirely. There isn't any middle ground between feeling problems and no problems. Now, the fearful ones, they want to attain some attainment so they can feel that they've solved their problems within duality. And so they think they want the spiritual path, but they never do it. They never get around to doing it, actually. They're looking for a trick. They think there's some trick somewhere that some teacher can teach them. So, no, there isn't. There's no exception. Either we feel we have the sense of problematicalness, or we feel that there's no problematicalness at all. Zero, none, zero, 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 zero. Now, getting to accept there's no problem is, you might say, the final problem, this final belief in a problem, which is the continuity fear, which pragmatically we can say, okay, well, we have one problem. So we can allow ourselves to say, okay, I have one problem, but it's temporary, and it's resolved through evaporating, not fixing it, but allowing it to evaporate. This is a very different thing than trying to fix a problem. So our very approach to this problem recognizes it's simply a familiarity issue, which isn't a real problem. And yet you might say it's a delaying device, a delaying device. So we don't have a problem. We do have this delaying device of continuity fear. We don't fix continuity fear. We allow it to evaporate. And when it's all evaporated, it's all evaporated. And we don't condense it anymore, unless that's what we want to do. We don't condense anymore because we're abiding in the problem-free, non-dual reality and getting used to it. The more we get used to it, the less possibility there is for continuity fear to return, to precipitate it, to return. It won't return because we're getting used to reality as it is. It's not we're getting used to the absence of continuity fear so much, is we're getting used to reality as it is. And therefore we feel, I don't have any need to call back continuity fear. I don't have any need to call it back. It's gradually. We feel this way. So non-dual positivity training right now. This is December. This is what we need to do, everything we can do in December to hit the ground running in January 2016. In this very, very keenly positive state of mind of I'm choosing the problem-free condition. I'm choosing the problem-free condition. Condition where there are no problems. I'm not choosing to solve problems. That's the ego. The ego always wants to solve problems. We're not trying to solve problems. We're trying to recognize that there aren't any. We're absolutely free. How could we have a problem? If we don't like something, we just choose a different experience. We don't have a problem. No one has a problem. There are no problems, actually. This is truth. But we have to see this for ourselves. Initially, we go on the faith of those who have seen it and those who have great faith in that, which I've both seen it and have great faith in those who have seen it and who are abiding in it. So I have a great deal of faith, but I've also corroborated what they have said, what they've shown us, and I found out, indeed, it is true. Indeed, it is true. So we're helped by the faith and the advice and the examples to believe that there is a perspective, that the reality, from the perspective of reality, there aren't any problems at all. So nothing needs to be fixed from that perspective. And that's all that needs to happen. We need to transfer our perspective from one to the other. Now, when we see that there aren't any problems at all, we hardly want to keep entertaining an effort to convince ourselves that there is. So in this whole world is an effort to convince ourselves that there are problems. But we also want to honor our creativity, so we don't get rid of the world. We don't get rid of anything. We just see it in a different way that infers reality, problem-freeness. Nothing in itself, nothing that we're seeing is seen as problematical, actually. It's only our misinterpretations and our willful desire to change what we are that gets us to believe that they're problems. Because again, we're completely free. We're spirit. We're not body, we're spirit. So positivity, non-dual positivity training. I may start a blog on this to help us out. How important it is? Well, I'd say it's all important. 2016 is shaping up to be the most problematical. I think beyond problematical, you might say. It's a heightened sense of problematicalness by those who are very fear-based, projecting this fear externally. They want an external threat that they can then displace, project this inner disturbance that they're feeling, trying to ignore, deny that reality exists. They feel without the sense of, I don't have any reality, my reality is being threatened so terribly. And then instead of saying they're the ones who are trying to threaten their own reality by denying it exists, they project this externally onto some threatening situation in the world. Threatening. So they love the news, they love all the crime books and stories and drama, all this, the threat, the suffering, all they feel, oh, I've got to have this, because that's the only way I can project this inner threat I'm feeling, so I don't look at it and realize that I'm the one who's trying to threaten my own reality. And of course, we're so creative, we feel that we can threaten reality, but the fact is, we can't. We cannot. Sure, we're creative, but we can't change what we are. We didn't create ourselves, so we can't uncreate ourselves. Has died down. So yeah, 2016 could be the year of extreme external disturbance. It's trending in that direction faster and faster and faster and faster and faster, and everybody realizes that there is some trend taking place in the world, right? And everybody's kind of jittery about it, actually, and kind of quite serious and feeling, I'm not sure I'm prepared for, I feel kind of unprepared for something. I'm not sure what it is, and I'm not sure how to prepare. And I'm not, well, we here know exactly what it is, in theory, of theory, and exactly how to prepare for it in theory, and carrying out specific steps to prepare. Some sort of impairment, maybe we, you know, some sort of excuse for projection, for displacement. This is, duality always has to generate an excuse for projection, always. That's what it does. So you look at the history of dualistic dream, and it's always impairment. There's always tides and ebbs and flows of impairment taking place. Look in history, if you're a student in history, which I am, in my own way, the way I've looked at it very carefully, and just realize, wow, this is what's happened here. Pretty steady stream of extreme impairment. But we're told by prophecy that this impairment in these end times here will be the worst ever. The worst ever. So I don't know what to make of that, but we certainly want to take the opportunity to recognize we don't need this anymore. We don't need that. We don't need it. We're aware of where that, how that, the concatenation, the chain of how do you get to that bad place of impairment, and we say, we don't need it. We can look directly at the whole chain and say, oh, okay, I can set the whole thing down at once. The whole thing down at once. I don't need to do it piecemeal. We don't have time for piecemealness. We can do it all at once, actually, and do a shift where, oh, okay, I can see, now I'm seeing that problems really can't exist. There's no such thing as a real problem at all. These are just fantasies, of hallucinations of those who are trying to change what they are, trying to change reality. And we don't need that. And we're not trying to change reality anymore. We're giving that up. So we don't have this feeling that our reality is being threatened. If you know, we take the goal of us trying to change reality, and since we are reality, we're spirit, and we're so creative, that we can really make ourselves feel like, oh my gosh, reality is really under dire threat. It hasn't, you know, it hasn't really been changed yet, although we can imagine, infer that it has, play this game of inference from this world, but we can feel, oh, it's theoretically, it seems like it could fall and be destroyed because we're so creative. But unfortunately, we didn't create ourselves, so we cannot uncreate ourselves. We didn't create reality, we cannot uncreate reality. It's impossible. But we can certainly feel that reality is under great siege and threat. And if we don't recognize that we're the ones that doing this, then projection is inevitable. It is unavoidable and inevitable. And so it's generally massive projection that takes place. Massive projection. This is the so-called lies that we have led here. Result of massive projection. It's inevitable unless we repent. Repent means to look within and recognize we're the ones who are trying to threaten reality. And we then and recognize we can't. So we just have a familiarity, continuity issue. Like, how do I set down this massive effort and projection, this massive projection and, you know, all this creativity involved in projection and denial and defensiveness and all this. How do we, you know, recognize it and say we don't need to keep doing this? This is the spiritual path of practicing and evaporating continuity fear that we do. So, neither success nor failure. Neither success nor failure. I am, is. It's neither success, nor is it failure, nor anything in between, nor combination, no compoundment, no uncompoundment. It's neither, reality is neither compounded nor uncompounded. It's neither compounded nor uncompounded. Neither compounded nor uncompounded. Now, as far as the good habits, again, mentioning these, I'm taking on a lot of good habits, trying, and it's essential, really. We cannot allow the fear-based ones to dictate to us what our options are. So, for instance, stop the news. Stop watching the news on both television, newspaper, internet, whatever source you get the news from. I've cut it off. Radio. Don't listen to the radio anymore. I haven't listened to the radio for quite some time now. Holy Spirit said, it's time to stop. And I stop. Have not gone back to it. I'm not even watching sporting events at this time either. So I've not even watched, not even turning the television on. Not turning the television on. Not turning the radio on. Not reading books. Not reading magazines. Not doing a little bit on the internet. I'll look at a few little sports issues just to stay so I can converse with people. Say, hey, how are the Warriors doing? Oh yeah, they're doing great. It's just sort of a socialization thing that it gives you opportunity to just be with someone, kind of share your presence with them. Yeah, someone got hit in the neck with something. I saw him today, you could tell that his whole energy had dropped, and his there was a dullness to him. And it's like, wow, it wasn't himself that I saw before. He said he's okay, but he's not okay. So someone really zapped him. Good, very good person. So we don't want dullness now. We want to sharpen the edge. Sharpen the edge. Keep sharpening the edge. What else are we going to do? Opportunity is on its way. Is knocking for us. I've been assured of this. I have many, many, many experiences that corroborate that there's some sort of opportunity on its way. Just the flip side is that there's some, you know, very intense fear-based stuff on the way. So I try not to talk about negative stuff as much. Most people, you start talking to them any length of time, and immediately it goes very negative, extremely negative. Wow, I'm noticing this. Maybe you're noticing this too, that the conversation becomes very gruesome quickly. This shows that they've been training in fear-based, dualistic fear-based training. And trying to put a polish on it, of course, to deflect any genuine train, non-dual positivity train, because they like to say, oh no, look, I'm spiritual, yeah, look at this polish I have here, and yet their focus is on fear-based, dualistic problem solving. They're looking for a hero to solve their problems. This makes things worse. That's an anti-hero, anti-Christ that comes in to solve problems. Jesus said, your faith has made you whole, meaning they realize, I don't need impairment. I don't need sickness. I don't need to try to change what I am. I don't need to believe in problems. I've made up the whole issue of problems. It's something I've completely made up, totally made up, without any exception whatsoever. And we allow the temporary pragmatic continuity fear issue, it's not a problem, it's an issue we have, to evaporate, not to fix it, but to evaporate it. And we just let it go. We let it go. We allow it to happen. We're not fixing it. That's why I say full stop on the wow. We're not saying, okay, well, I found the problem. What do I need to do to fix? I got to fix. No, we just let the continuity fear evaporate. Be very pragmatic and practical here. This is the way. Now, it is not easy. Don't overdo it. I didn't try to do leg work today running because my legs were too sore. And the Holy Spirit pointed out, give yourself a couple days off from it. Let you recharge your batteries, your leg. So I did flexibility and training with the upper body and just overall flexibility, which is really good. And so it sort of alternate. Don't overdo it. Say, okay, I gotta get in shape, I'm gonna run every day for the next month. This is going to actually wear you down and get injuries, etc. Alternate, whether you're doing strength, flexibility, and cardio, alternate those and allow do whatever you can do for several days, and then switch over to another ones, and maybe run for a couple days, and don't do any too much strength or flexibility. It'll allow that to calm down. Don't go on a radical fast. Don't do that. Just limit, try to limit the amount of food you eat. A lot of berries. A lot of berries, a lot of fruits, which is what I'm doing. A berry smoothie every day. I have a Odwalla fruit protein drink. What is it, about 12 or 16 ounces, something like that. And I have frozen berries of different types. Cranberry, blueberry, boysenberry, I mean all sorts of berry mix, strawberry. I probably should put a banana into it, and I think maybe I will, because that helps. That's good too. And I mix those two together in a NutriBullet. And this is a smoothie. And then this is what I just drink during the day for the most part. And then come home, have an early dinner, which I did tonight, about 5 o'clock. Wheat berries, and with cranberries, and a mix with, and then tabbouleh, and some feta cheese. That's the dinner. But in the morning, I had like an egg, a piece of toast, an egg, and some cheese, and cottage cheese, and yogurt. And at nighttime, also before I go to bed, I have some Greek yogurt, actually. Let's try to keep the protein level up. So as we're getting a bit better shape, losing some weight, we want to keep our strength going too. So we're not trying to tear ourselves down here. Flexible strength, and this provides at least an imaginary, practical base for positivity. Everything we can do to have imagine certain some base of positivity until we recognize the baseless space of pure positivity. The baseless space of pure positivity. We say baseless space again, so we don't get rid of the notion that there's some base to our base. Like, success. Success. And these old habits of duality die hard. There's no question about it. I've been working very intensely on this. And even since experiencing abundance, it's been over a year now. And I saw what the problem was. And it's still, it's like a bad cold. It's still lingering on. And I just keep wearing away, wearing away, wearing away, working on it. And so I can tell you that you don't give up. It's difficult. These are very ancient habits that we've been engaging with for so long. And the continuity fear is there, still there. And so it doesn't just yield easily. It might give us a glimpse to give us to think, oh, maybe it yields easily. And then where'd it go? I can't get it back. And it just keep working at it. This is my advice. This is the best advice there is anyone can ever give, and anyone else is keep working at it. That's a true friend, is those who say keep working at it. You will succeed eventually. This is what my teachers have told me. You just have to wear it away, evaporate it. The continuity fear eventually will evaporate. As they say, for sure, you keep working at it. You will succeed. A good saying, a saint is a sinner that never gave up. Never give up evaporating the continuity fear. Keep working at non-duality, neither success nor failure. Neither lies nor absence of lies. Neither a trace nor tracelessness. Try that. Neither a trace nor tracelessness. So this is the neither nor practice is a more powerful practice. So you might say it supersedes the other practice. The other practices are fine. We can say reality is baseless, it's traceless. That's an is thing. It is, it is, it is, it is, it is. We've done that already, and that's very helpful. So there's nothing wrong at all if that's where you're at. And that's a powerful exercise too. But the neither nor is even more powerful. It's neither neither has a trace, is nor traceless. There's not a, neither a trace nor tracelessness. Neither trace nor tracelessness. Neither boundaries nor boundarylessness. Boundaryless. Boundarylessness, is that something? Yeah. Neither boundaries nor no boundaries. Neither base nor no base. Neither not whatever. Neither nor. This helps train us in the abstraction that we need. This is what's important. Neither this nor that. Neither this nor that. Neither this nor that. Not even the cherished middle. Not even the cherished middle. Not even any neutrality. It's neither neutral nor non-neutral. It's neither this nor that. The base can only be experienced. It can never be objectified. It can never, that's what Ramana Maharshi said, that we're trying to objectify reality and it cannot be objectified, and this is our trouble. So we have to practice non-objectification. We have to practice non-objectification. Practice it. You know, how did Steph Curry get to be such a, you know, world beater of a basketball player? Practice, practice, practice. He's a practice fiend. He does very advanced practices. He does stress overload practices. They put strobe lights on. They do all sorts of things to stress out his senses. And then he's shooting baskets and dribbling. And then they take these mechanisms off of him. And it makes then he does the practice and it's like, wow, there's hardly any stress, comparatively little stress, and it's easier for him. He does stress overload training. He's one of the few people that do that as trainers back in North Carolina. And this information has just come out. His training is just like, wow, quite extraordinary. They intentionally interfere with his senses, restricting and causing confusion, everything. And then he practices that way. So he tries to get good even when he's under all this confusion, sensory problem, and then again in the game, but it mimics the game of all the stuff, people flying at him and stuff like that, and he seems just like so poised and smooth. It's like nothing's bothering him. People, he's extraordinary. Well, because he's been practicing this way. There's something that people, this is just coming to light. All kudos to him, because this is very intelligent. He understood advanced practicing, which is why he's such an advanced basketball player, one of the most advanced we've ever seen. Maybe even the most advanced in terms of overall skill set. Because he's intelligent enough to practice in a way which really, really keeps challenging him, challenging and challenging and challenging. Well, this is an example. This, how you get good is you practice in an intelligent way. So you have to keep pushing the boundaries. If you got a good trainer, like his trainer, hardly anyone knows his trainer, but his trainer is like a genius. He keeps coming up with new practices to challenge him, challenge him, challenge him. We need to do the same thing here, is keep challenging ourselves and practice this. Practice, practice, practice. Neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor. So maybe I needed to do this and just throw a whole bunch of practices out there. I've done it before, and people, there's not been much response, actually. People say, why do I need to practice? Because we have been trying to objectify what cannot be objectified for so long that the notion of not objectifying seems like the loss of reality to us. That's why. Continuity fear. Says, oh my gosh, I wouldn't know what reality is. Of course, we'd be experiencing it, but we don't realize that, you know, in our belief. So we need to practice non-objectification as a practice. When Steph Curry is practicing with these, you know, strobe lights, he wears goggles and all these things that are, and they have lights up here, the distraction, all sorts of stuff. He knows this isn't a game that he's playing. He's practicing. So if he misses shots, if he, misdribbles the ball, he says, hey, that's fine. I expect that. I'm stressing myself out here. But let me keep trying at it. And then when the game comes, then he knows, well, this is the real game. Obviously, there's a difference. So when we're practicing stressing, practicing non-objectification. We're not trying to weave a structural theory when we're practicing. We're practicing getting used to non-objectification, just getting used to it, obviously. And I guess only those who have the intelligence to see this practice. Otherwise they get into level confusion, say, wait a minute, you, as if the practice were an end in itself. We're practicing non-objectification. So we can say anything we want to say, as long as we put it in a format which helps us just feel, oh, I'm not there's no objectification there in my conceptual formulation there. You know, some things we practice will hit home harder than others. This is what I've experienced. So keep searching for those things that really, wow, I didn't realize I could non-objectify that. Wow, that's really profound. It shocks us, and then the wow comes up because we have these cherished objectifications that we have been working on, that are, we cherish them, and we think, oh, everything else is not, can't be objectified, but this is the way. And so when we say even this way is not the way, that's when the wow rises for us. Our bell really gets rung at that point. And I've just put hundreds of videos together stressing all of this. So hopefully, you know, in the watching of these and the saying of these and doing it, we're getting more and more familiar with non-objectification, which is, that's the ticket. It really is the ticket. Then when the stress is on, the game, the world, we say, hey, dribble right through it. No problem. Easy to score. And walk right out the tunnel. Say, folks, you know, this game is a piece of cake for me. I don't need to prove, nothing to prove here. I'll see you later. There's nothing to prove here. There's no narrative to prove. I don't need to prove any narrative of objectification. I don't need a good narrative of objectification necessarily, right? Well, we can allow ourselves just one, which would be the death-free realm. That's all we need. It's just one. That's it. But draw the line right there. And then it's obvious to us, like, oh, this is the final profound inference of reality as it is. So this will help us relinquish all remaining even temptation towards objectification, trying to objectify reality. But again, these niceties of explanation are not important in the training actually. We need to get into a spiritual training state of mind, like Steph Curry gets into a physical training sort of thing. They say he's the most marketable athlete person in the world right now, and he probably is. We here in the Bay Area know him quite well. He was drafted with the Warriors, so I followed his progress since he was drafted from Davidson in North Carolina, and then coming to the Warriors as a rookie, and then injuring his ankles a bunch of times, and this whole saga, and so we know him. We know how good he is, and what a good person he is, what a good spokesperson he is, what a decent person he is, an intelligent person. This is being, you know, marketed throughout the world. He's become a mega, mega superstar, but he knows where it came from. It came from hard work, not just hard work, intelligent practice. It came from intelligent practice. He does all these drills, very, very difficult, sophisticated drills, dribbling drills, shooting drills, you name it. Another player I named Kobe Bryant also work. Steph works, I think, more intelligently, smarter in his training and practices, etc. And he's always pushing himself to get better, and his increase in skill set has just been unprecedented. I've never seen anything like it in sports. How much better he has gotten every year. He keeps getting better and better and better and better and better, and people are just saying, wow, I don't think we've ever seen anything like this, actually. But the secret, he knows, he stays humble because he knows it's just because I'm practicing very intelligently here, and it's working. That's okay. It works. So he's just not doing the same old everybody else is doing. It's like, well, I know where that gets you, but let's try some advanced training techniques. And that is what he has done. He's doing advanced training techniques. And there's nothing preventing us from doing advanced training techniques. And I've been trying to push this and say, folks, this is what we need to do. I don't know what more I can do. But you have to want to be the best. Now, what I say, everybody should try to be the very best in the world. the very best, the most prepared, the most spiritually literate, be the best, most non-dual prepared, most non-dual positively prepared person in the world. This is what I want everyone's goal to be. This is should be the goal, okay? I want everyone to be the best non-dual positively prepared mind, spirit in this world, or just that there is no other that is better prepared. The top, you know, this make this a goal. Make this a goal for everyone. So this is just sort of an open-ended goal. Every day I got to work it. I got to get better. I want to be the very best there is. Like in my life, this is the way I always feel. I always felt I want to be the very best there is. Whatever, just want to be the very best there is, and I'm not stopping until I am. And this idea, let's be the most non-dual positively prepared mind there is. How could that be a negative goal? It's a very positive goal. And you don't have to compete with anybody. You just say, hey, I'm going to, you know, for me, I'm just going to try and raise myself up to the highest non-dual positive preparation possible. Let's put it that way. I'm going to raise myself up to the highest non-dual positive preparation possible. Now, Steph Curry has a whole bunch of people practicing basketball now. Kids are getting into it. They say, wow, I can be like him. He's not big. But they don't understand really what he did, what he has done. He was born into a family, NBA family. His father, Del Curry, was a star, NBA star, great shooter. His whole life has been very, very positive role models. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. You can do this. Yes, you can. This is very, very helpful. Yes, yes, I can do this. I know I can do this. My dad did it. You know, I'm reinforced. They say, of course you can. And then applying very, very intelligent training techniques and discipline in your life. Leads a very disciplined life too. Doesn't want to stray off track. And he surrounds himself with people that are that way too. You know, let's live on the straight and narrow here, and let's stick to business. So you have a lot of kids shooting basketballs now, but they don't quite realize, you know, what it takes actually, what it really takes. And this should be made clear. It should be made clear. Same spiritual path. You see someone like Ramana Maharshi, and people say, oh yeah, I want to be like Ramana Maharshi, but they don't quite understand what it takes. It needs to be made clear that we can do it, but certainly it's going to be challenging for us, and we have to continually challenge ourselves and be creative. And it's an art. It's not a science. It's an art. We have to manage our success, wisely manage our success. It's a commitment. It's a business. It's a career. It's a vocation. It's a hobby. It's everything. All of those rolled into one. It's a dedication. And there is no shortcut. There really is no shortcut, magical shortcut, other than just continual practice and wisely managing success. There isn't any way around that. That's it. And then you'll go as fast as you can go. But the wows will arise, and you have to allow that to resonate and settle down. Continuity feel arise. You have to work on evaporating it. Success will arise. You have to work on managing your success and staying focused and saying, okay, but I have to keep working. I'm getting glimpses of success. I'm passing milestones. Okay, but that's not it. I got to keep working. Non-dual abidance is the goal. Of course I will know when I reach that. There's no question. There's no questions that need to be answered. Once we're in non-dual abidance, we know it. There's no questions there. It's unquestionable. There's no problems there. So what is there to fix the question? No, that's it. So we have to abide in this, where there are no questions nor answers. And we're so used to believing in justification with all these questions, like how the heck does this work anyway? And then struggling for answers, all these problems arising, struggling to find answers to these problems, problematicalness. But there are some who get into advanced training because they want to be really, really good. They expect it. Say, I'm going to be tremendous. This is really going to help me. I was a practicing fiend in basketball. I really was. Everything I've done, I've practiced, trying to be the best at it. And I did all sorts of dribbling and shooting, different creative exercises, always inventing new stuff. Just like the soccer player, same thing. I mean, you have, what was it, George Best used to take runs through the countryside with a soccer ball, kicking the soccer ball as he ran. Yeah, they talk about an exercise. Talk about developing skills. Try that. Going cross country with a soccer ball. Kicking a soccer ball all the way. Managing it as you go along the pebbles, the rocks, the tilted landscape, this and this and this and that. And that's a very, very, very creative exercise. Well, they say Pele is great, but George is best. except he couldn't handle the fame. Didn't know how to manage his success, so Pele was better, really. I mean, got to know how to manage your success. He thought the bottle, George Best thought the bottle was the way to manage his success. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. He thought that's how to do it. Then he said, "No, that's not it. I messed up." So when you're practicing, you have to realize this is going to bring success. Big success. And recognize this, and the wow arises. So it seems to slow you down. See, the problem is if you keep practicing and then it and don't think about the fact that the success is going to come and prepare for that, then when it hits, you won't know how to handle it. I go, "Oh, I'm not, am I really this good? How did I do this?" And no. We're not that naive like that. You cannot afford to be naive. So the preparation is not just to reach success, but to stay in success, or actually freedom from success is what we're really after. We say, "I can be free of success, I will be free of success, I am already free of success." It's success is what really is getting in the way of recognizing our perfection. What kind of success does perfection need? What kind of success does perfection need? That doesn't need any. The whole notion of success is completely dualistic because it's based on success and failure. It's setting up a false dichotomy that doesn't is completely unnecessary and has no base in reality at all. It's trying to set up a false dualistic dichotomistic base of success failure. There is no such base. There's only perfection. There's only perfect freedom. That's the only base there is. So we let go of this false base. We think, "Oh, I won't have any base at all." Well, of course we'll have the base of perfection. So, along the way, you may have encounters with great spiritual teachers. May happen. It happened. It's happened with me. It's happened in my case. And you gradually get used to that, and you say, "Okay, yeah, that's what happens. That's fine." And gradually, you just take it in stride. And you say, "This is what I do. These are my friends. These are my friends. This is just how it is. I don't need any success. I'm free of all notion of success. I can be free of success. I will be free of success. I'm already completely free of all success, which reveals what the perfection that I am. What veils it from us is our efforts towards success. Success at what? Getting rid of problems, right? We don't realize it, but all the success that we're trying for, it ultimately is aimed to try to get rid of problems. There's always an aspect of our mind, whether that's projected as another person, a special relationship with someone, your friends, or whatever, expectations that you're the hero. You're going to get rid of the problems for them. So your success is going to then get rid of the problems for them. This is what veils the fact that we're all intrinsically perfect, and we cannot change that at all. So I had a series of realizations today, very profound. And I'm just saying, okay, this is what I expect. This is my life. This is what happens. I'm being super successful. Now, here in the West, we all have this inferiority complex, which makes it quite difficult. Like, well, nobody here can, you know, do as good as they do in India or Tibet or whatever. Well, of course we can. We're already perfect. What do you mean, can't do as good? I mean, our perfection is the same as anyone, their perfection. There's no difference. It's just they have accepted it. And we're still looking for some sort of success, which avoids the acceptance of perfection. That's how we avoid it. Although, again, honoring our creativity, we will look for the success in setting success down. However, it's not a narrative. It's tricky. But at least we'll work towards that. But ultimately, there's no narrative. Well, how did you get success? I didn't have any success. There is no success narrative here at all. So say this. This is a creative way of practicing. I have no success narrative whatsoever. I have no answers whatsoever. I have no success narrative. I have no narrative of success whatsoever. None. I simply have accepted that what I am is inherent perfection. That is not based on any narrative at all. Either a success or non-success, or anything in between, or even a neutral story, narrative. So we have a nice soundtrack here, basketball soundtrack. It's great. Love it. That's what I did when I was a kid. I'd shoot hoops at night, set up a light outside, wintertime, I'd shoot till midnight. I said, I gotta make this shot 10 times in a row. I'm not gonna stop until I make it 10 times in a row. we can all do this. We have to want it, want something bad enough that we practice. Now, I was trying to show people I could be successful because the world had pushed me into, you know, pressured me into that they think, well, we have to have some success. So you know, what kind of success can we have? Actually, no, we don't need any success, even including the success of no success. This is practice. Now, pragmatically, for the purposes of speaking ordinarily, we might allow for the success of no success, but there's no narrative to it. Because really, in spiritual help, you're helping people practice. So we cannot get caught up in dialogue. This is the trap. Dialogue is the trap, actually. You cannot value dialogue. It is merely a filler in between episodes of practicing. It's merely a filler. Take it with a grain of salt. We can use it to flip the script, and that's the most helpful way. But it's merely a filler in between practicing. Reality has no narrative at all. So how can you have a narrative how we got to reality? We didn't get to reality. We never left it. Well, what's the narrative to realization? The narrative is to practice no narrative. And just keep practicing it. That's the answer. to, you know, how do you, what's the narrative? What's the answer? The answer is to keep practicing no answer. Until eventually get used to it. And then abidance will be easy. That's all. And this is where the trouble comes from everyone. This is where we have the trouble. And most, well, we all have trouble with this. We all have trouble with it. I've had severe trouble with it, but I just didn't give up. I said, I can't afford to give up. And I've said again, poverty is a blessing. I talked to someone today and to explain that to him. He got it. He understood it. It's a blessing because you have very little options, very few options. So you say, well, I might as well then just work at this. What else can I do? People with money, what do? They spend it. They go out and do stuff with it. And instead of sitting here like we're doing, you know, practicing very, very, very intelligently, they're out trying to find the easy way. Say, maybe my money can buy it somehow. Buy companionship, buy things, buy, you know, whatever I think is going to make me successful. But we know that we need to get free of success. The whole notion of success. We need to get free of the whole notion of success. In terms of practicing, not pragmatically, like, well, I'm not going to have anything to eat or what we mean. No, we're practicing non-objectification, non-answers, non-success. Because again, reality has no need for those whatsoever. They don't really exist in reality at all. No such thing as success. What could freedom say it's successful at? It's inherently free. Didn't create the freedom. It can't say, I'm successful at freedom. And with perfect freedom, how can we claim success? Success, what do you mean? It's meaningless. I did something? Well, I'm free to do whatever I want to do, as long as I want to do it. It's not a question of I attained some success. It doesn't exist in that way. Non-dual positivity training. Training. So, put yourself, you know, neither a trace nor traceless. Neither a trace nor no trace. Neither a trace nor no trace. This pushes our buttons. Neither a trace nor no trace. Neither a trace nor no trace. Don't try to figure it out. Get familiar. Allow familiarity to settle in. Neither a trace nor no trace. This is the Zen koan practice, essentially. Spiritual teachers have devised all sorts of training techniques. Lots of them. Lots of them. And one of the, one of them, we, in general, we call it Zen Koan, where you're given something that's that you can't seem to resolve, and this breaks down the belief, you know, in objectification. But you shouldn't break it down. You should just get familiar with. They say just hold the koan there. And just let it be there. And this what it does is evaporates the continuity fear towards non-objectification. This is what it does. So that's a very pragmatic practice. Neither a trace nor no trace, neither a trace nor no trace, neither a trace nor no trace, neither success nor failure, neither success nor failure. I am neither a success nor am I a failure, nor am I anything in between, nor am I any combination thereof, nor a lack of combination thereof. I'm neither a success nor am I a failure. I'm neither a combination thereof nor a non-combination thereof. Now, when our practicing brings us to this edge of fear, of oh my gosh, I'm on the edge of non-reality here, because we're not objectifying. We think objectification, our belief in objectification, is reality, is the new reality. It's replaced the old one. We think it was replaced the one. Reality's been replaced by believing in objectification, which is of course dualism. You have to have dualism to objectify, don't you? You have to have a, they call it the seer and the seen, but really, you have to have at least two-ness, right? Objectification. What is it that's doing the objectifying? What is it experiencing the objectification? The eye. We say, oh, there's an eye that is seeing this. Well, this is spiritual talk, but practice is more important. Neither lies nor absence of lies. Neither lies nor absence of lies. Neither lies nor absence of lies. Neither success nor absence of success. Neither success nor failure. Neither success nor failure. And neither combination thereof nor a non-combination thereof. Neither the presence nor the absence. Neither the presence nor the absence. Reality is neither the presence nor is it the absence of anything at all. Duality is really saying that there are two bases. There's a base of a base. The base of the base. That the one doing the objectifying is actually more basic than the base. It's the one viewing the base, so to speak, but that there's only the base. There's no one viewing the base. We are the experiencing. There's not an experiencer, so to speak, experiencer and experience and the experienced. This is objectification. But don't try to intellectually figure that out. Practice. I'm neither the experiencer nor the non-experiencer. I'm neither an experiencer nor am I a non-experiencer. I'm neither an experiencer nor am I a non-experiencer. I'm neither a combination of experiencer and non-experiencer, nor am I a non-combination of experiencer and non-experiencer. So as we challenge ourselves this way, later on down the road you find out, oh, stuff's easy, it's easy, it's not a problem at all. I don't have any fear reactions like I'm going off a cliff into non-reality. Very, very, very mild. It gets milder and milder and milder. This is what I've experienced, that the fear gets milder and milder and milder. It's kind of like driving from a cold climate to a warm climate, driving from Alaska to Palm Springs desert. Gradually it gets milder, 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 milder. Go to Anchorage, Alaska, to Palm Springs, California. Start out, it's minus to whatever. Or Billings, Montana, or somewhere. It's real cold. Minus 20 degrees, minus 40. And you drive, and it just gradually as you go, you say, hey, it's not quite as cold. But you're going slowly enough so that you acclimatize as you go along. And by the time you arrive in the desert, it's 85, and if it's winter, it's 85, and you feel like, ah, yeah, this is great, I like this, and it feels real good, and not a problem, because I gradually have been traveling there and acclimatized to it. neither the experiencer nor the non-experiencer. There is no narrative to tell. You see, when I was in abidance, someone would say, well, where's the narrative? And they say, we have a better narrative. Well, I say, how can you say you have a better narrative? I don't have any narrative. Really, the only category then is you have a narrative, at least you're pursuing one, and I'm not. It's not a question of better or worse narrative. As soon as you accept the better and worse narrative, you're in duality again. And that pulled me out of abidance. It pulled me out. I lost focus on it. Lost acceptance of it. Because I say, well, yeah, well, my narrative, what kind of narrative I have? I don't have any narrative. I am does not have any narrative. Doesn't matter what kind of narrative I believed in. I am doesn't have any narrative. So, those who are claiming narrative, you say, you're following a narrative? I'm not following any narrative. So you can't say you have a better narrative. It makes no sense. I'm just talking gibberish. And this is what I discovered in coming into this world, that people are just speaking gibberish. But after a while, it wears you down, and you start trying to make sense of their gibberish. You're tired of their gibberish, and you want to understand what they're saying. It's just gibberish. It's all it is. So, there's nothing to decipher. Gibberish is gibberish. But they say, well, yeah, but I have fancy gibberish. Gibberish is gibberish. There's no such thing as meaningful, fancy, or not fancy. It's still gibberish. That's still the category. It doesn't change the category at all. You see, they think that well, I got a better gibberish. It changes category, doesn't it? It remains gibberish. It's saying I have something better than... I have a better narrative than no narrative. No, that's a false dichotomy, isn't it? So they set up this false dichotomy that lures us in like a terrible trap, a terrible mental trap. False dichotomy. One and zero is not a dichotomy. One can't say to zero, I've got a lot more than you have, or I have, you know, more than you have. Zero doesn't have anything. The concept of more and less doesn't exist. You know, they say, have a better narrative. No, you have a narrative. I don't have any narrative. It's not more narrative. It's not better narrative. A narrative is not a better narrative than no narrative. So this is what we see in our mind. We recognize this. These are the recognitions that are so important, and we just keep working on them, keep recognizing them, until they have to become old hat to us. We're not neophytes, dilettantes. This is like something that's just, of course, I'm very familiar with this. Of course, these are my thoughts. These are the thoughts I think with the Holy Spirit. These are the thoughts I think with the Holy Spirit. I didn't wear my jacket. That's why I'm feeling cold. Yeah. The chill is setting a little bit. Well, Oh wow, the rain is coming Thursday. So I got just one more day before the rain hits. Wow. Supposed to be a lot of rain in the Pacific Northwest. Heavy, heavy stuff. Some places of 8 inches. And they're talking about, big amounts of snow, 3 to 5 feet of snow. So this is a strong, strong ocean, atmospheric ocean coming in. And we're just going to get just the very tail end of it, so to speak, the southern end of it. But still, it's going to be significant. Little intervals between practice. Little intervals between practice. We have to become good at this. I'm taking a little interval, but don't get too wrapped up in it. Say, okay, I'll get back to practice a little while here. The ego fools almost everyone here in the world. It's a piece of cake for it. Says, ah, you're too young to practice. Just enjoy life now. You'll never be young again. Enjoy it. By the time you get older, then it says, "Oh, you're too old to practice. You wasted your life. It's too difficult to start now." And we just go life after life after life after life after life like this. The ego just playing us for fools. So I said, "No, I'm going to get started right now. That's it. Maybe I'll finish in a day, maybe a year, maybe 10 years, maybe not even this life. I don't know, but." I'm starting right now. And this is the most difficult decision, but the most effective decision we could ever make. I'm starting right now. And you just say to the ego, that's it. You're toast. You're toast. I'm going to start evaporating the continuity fear. There's nothing you can do about it. And at some point, I won't need you to hang around anymore. So I know the ego's going to hang around until I finish. It's okay. So why struggle with it? Try to get rid of it. Anything. When it's gone, it's gone. When the continuity fear is gone, the ego will be gone. When you have the big insights, then you end up giving an interval so you can just feel like everything is okay. This is the new norm. This is the new normal. Non-dual positivity training is the new normal for me. Non-dual positivity training is the new normal for me. Non-dual positivity training is the new normal for me. So let's start out with that. Non-dual positivity training is the new normal for me. I can do it. I will do it. I'm already doing it. I can do it. I will do it. I'm already doing it. Okay, very great. I'm not going to freeze out here. So we'll wrap this one up. It's not too long, hour and 15 minutes or so. Okay. And we'll see.